MD Custom RX has done a wonderful job over the years of both predicting and welcoming drugs into practice that are repurposed or off-label use but still have utility. Some of these drugs that MD Custom RX Pharmacy has brought into use and has done very well would be low-dose naltrexone, ivermectin, methylene blue, to name a few of them. Well, we believe we're on the cusp of yet another cornerstone medication for functional medicine related to aging in a broad sense in age-related diseases. So that's what today's video is going to be about. Rapamycin, also known as sirolimus, also known as Rapamoon, that's the brand name. It's an FDA-approved medication that has immune-modulating properties and growth-inhibitory properties. It is actually derived from a bacteria called Streptomyces Hydroscopicus or Hygroscopicus. Rapamycin is like that bacteria's defense mechanism that it produced, has antifungal properties to it. But we're able to extract that, synthesize it, and make it in mass amounts, right? So that's something that we can do for the human population that'll be good. But it is derived naturally, and it's potentially becoming widely recognized as one of the newest anti-aging broad-spectrum medications that can be given later in life. So it doesn't have to be early stage intervention to lengthen lifespan. It can be given later stage, even over the age of 50 years old. So in this two-part series, we'll go through some of the reasons, how it works, side effects, potential dosing, and why we think it's going to be a cornerstone in functional medicine as a preventative against age-related diseases, but also an anti-aging medication. So in order to understand a little bit more about what rapamycin is doing as an anti-aging medicine, we have to kind of define aging. That's still elusive. Everybody doesn't define it the same way, and there's multiple acceptable definitions of aging. The funny thing about aging is it's a sum of a lot of different parts. It's not one individual thing. So aging can be seen as the probability of gaining age-related diseases, which would cause your mortality. So as you age, you eventually are going to run into an age-related disease, or at least your probability goes higher and higher till eventually one or a couple of them cause your demise. There's also aging based on molecular and cellular damage. So that's from environmental factors. So you can have aging coming in through genetic factors, but also environmental factors. And what this boils down to, and some other videos had kind of touched on the cellular and molecular damaging that's happened from aging, like methylene blue, that video talks about rescuing essentially an organelle called the mitochondria. And that's more or less trying to prolong the function of a cell that has been damaged on a cellular level. Rapamycin, on the other hand, is slowing down aging through what your body does to prevent aging. Ironically, it can also produce age-related diseases. So your body has the cell cycle. Like our cars, over time, we have to replace its parts, we have to wash it, time degrades everything. Well, your body's way of cheating that is going through the cell cycle. It's designed to have cell division, make more cells that are identical copies of that perfect first cell. This way you're nice and brand new throughout time. But unfortunately, due to environmental factors, some genetic factors, that cell cycle can get a little skewed one way or another. They have found something called mTOR. There's mTORC1 and mTORC2 that we'd be taking a look at in this video. mTOR stands for mammalian target of rapamycin. Yes, it's that specific to rapamycin, chicken or the egg, right? So the mTOR target, like the mTOR piece that rapamycin goes to, is already there in the body. It's just that we followed rapamycin and found what it was doing, so they called it target of rapamycin. So the human version is mammalian target of rapamycin. Anyways, mTOR is super critical for cell cycles, cell division, and functionality of the cell. We need it to supply protein, to communicate what part of the cell cycle should go, and just to overall have the best chance at doing the cell cycle properly and having cell division. The hard part, though, is if some of this is damaged or if it's not working correctly, the cell cycle, if it gets arrested, if there's still a dysregulation in mTOR, so if that is still hyperactive or activated when that cell cycle should probably die off, it can cause the hyperfunction of that cell line. So what would be the implications of this? Well, that it would be age-related diseases. So for instance, if you had hyperfunctioning immune cells, they release cytokines as a communication molecule, but that can lead to inflammation. So if you have dysregulated mTOR signaling of the cell cycle, you're going to get a bigger morphology, so a bigger cell, hyperfunctioning, releasing more cytokines, so it's releasing inflammation, so pro-inflammatory, autoimmune. That's kind of potentially, at least the pro-inflammatory part could be age-related. When it comes to, let's say, cardiovascular, your endothelial cells, macrophages are involved too. But if that cell cycle gets, if it becomes like, you know, unhealthy, and the mTOR is dysregulated and it's pushing the cell cycle through, even though it shouldn't be making these certain cells this way, they're going to have a big morphology as well, meaning a big, big cell, going to be hyperfunctioning. This is going to relate to hypertension. So that would be downstream of that. Potentially osteoporosis. I just spoke with a patient a little earlier today about osteoporosis. Well-known age-related disease, right? So osteoporosis, there's osteoclasts, osteoblasts. Osteoclasts help resorb the bone, meaning they help soak some bone in. Your bones are recycled, okay? So osteoclasts help resorb some of the bone. If it happens that that cell line has this mTOR, mammalian target of rapamycin, that's dysregulated, it can create a larger morphology, hyperfunctioning osteoclast. So it might resorb in an unbalanced way against osteoblasts, leading to osteoporosis. So I'm trying to paint a picture, and I know this is a lot of jumbled words, but I'm trying to paint a picture of outside of environmental factors that damage cells on a molecular and cellular level, talking about how your own body's program, its cell cycle, its cell division, how it tries to keep you fresh and new can also be the cause of age-related diseases and eventually mortality. Well, I wish I could say, you know, this is some innovative idea I came up with. It is not. This has been widely recognized. Tons of scientists and professionals are working on this. There's a bunch of studies on rapamycin that will get some data this year even as to what dosing should be done, because hopefully I painted a picture of where the utility is of rapamycin. Rapamycin can inhibit that mTOR. And if it inhibits the mTOR appropriately, we can prevent the growth or onset of age-related diseases. And if we define age as a set or probability of age-related diseases over time in your lifespan, well, we're certainly creating an anti-aging medication. And those examples are, it's not limited to just those examples. I mean, I think I just gave you a cardiovascular piece and a bone, a skeletal piece, but it's a broad spectrum. There's even studies showing currently that topical rapamycin on skin has anti-aging properties, and even to the subjective piece of healthier, younger looking skin. I was blown away by Methylene Blue's ability to do that. Hard part is getting Methylene Blue, not blue, into a cream. Some people have done it. Here at the pharmacy, we haven't taken a stab at it. We haven't had the demand for that. But rapamycin is another one that could be a topical cream, at the very least, used for healthier looking skin if we don't end up using it as a low dose for anti-aging. So, boy, oh boy, I hope you guys have been sticking in there, trying to paint a picture of how rapamycin is going to work. We're going to get into dosing. We're going to get into side effect profile, if there's anything you should consider. We're going to get into a study of people that are already taking it off-label, with providers already prescribing it off-label for anti-aging, and what their takes are. And it was like 500-some people in this study. It does have limitations, unfortunately, but it's the best we got right now. And then the promising look to the future. In 2024, we're going to have a lot of data on its effect on Alzheimer's, its effect on anti-aging from metabolic standpoint, cardiovascular standpoint. I mean, as many as we can. It's going to be big. This will be one of the staple functional medicine anti-aging pieces that we're going to have down the road. Thanks for your time.